like a suicide. I cry when angels deserve to die.
Welcome to episode two. This is Anthony Rizzo, and this is episode two. I got a bunch of different things to go over tonight, a bunch of topics. For one, I'm going to talk some music. I'm going to talk politics. I'm going to talk some baseball, football, basketball. There was a bunch of stuff in the news about Donald Trump. He went to court today. And we'll just go over some stuff. You know, I had a bunch of stuff going on in my house today, okay? I had a whole lot going on. You wouldn't even believe it. It was crazy. It was a crazy day. Just, wow. I'm glad everybody's asleep. I'm doing this right now at night, this episode. Everybody just needed to go to bed. I could not stand it anymore. Go the heck to bed. I've had enough. My kid, just, wow. He gets expelled from school. At least, I don't know if that's the case. That's how it's looking. So far, it's just a suspension. They said it could become expelled, though. I don't even know what to tell him. I don't know what to say. He came home, and he got his, okay? He got in trouble. I'm just going to leave it at that. He got his, okay? I don't believe in child abuse or anything like that, and I would never hurt my kids, but he was in trouble, big time. He wrote something on the, on the wall or on the window or something at school, and it was inappropriate, and apparently his friend put him up to it and this and that. He's got, a friend that apparently no one likes and that he'll never be talking for the rest of his life to. So he says some things. I'm not going to go into what he said, but he said they were very, very inappropriate, just out of this world, gets in trouble. Bad enough to get expelled. I'll put it to you that way. So he comes home. We talk to him. He ends up getting a punishment. I will just leave it at that. And, I'm almost at a loss for words. This kid has always been a great kid. He's about to be a teenager, like, next month. Okay? Always been a great kid. Does his chores, earns money. He works around the neighborhood. He's always been a really, really, really good kid. Very smart. Very, very intelligent. Shitty judgment. Okay? Shitty judgment. I mean, that comes with being immature, being a kid. He's about to be a teenager. He's 12 right now. Next month, he'll be 13. And just poor judgment all around. I mean, incredibly poor. So, he's a good kid, though. I don't know what to do. I mean, we took away all his electronics. He lost his phone. He lost, Xbox. He lost computer privileges. He lost this. He lost that. Because they're talking about putting him in one of those, like, BOCES type schools now, where they send the bad kids for, like, 3 months. They're talking about sending it to him and then maybe bringing him back. I don't know yet. I'll know more in a few days. So far, he's got a 3-day suspension, okay? But he very well may be kicked out of school. I need to know, has any other parents ever dealt with this? What would you do? Honestly, if your child wrote something on the wall, and it's not like he got into a fight, gave somebody, broke their arm, was the instigator, It didn't happen like that. He was writing something on a wall, they played in some inappropriate music or something, and boom. He gets hauled into the office. My wife has to go down there and pick him up. She gets a phone call at like 3:30 in the afternoon. She looks at me, says, I got to go to school now. I said, I don't have to go, right? She looks at me and just gives me that look. You know that look. If you're married, you know that look that I'm talking about. Okay? She gives me that look that could just burn a hole through a wall. So she just says, she gives me this look and she says, no. I'm like, okay, thank God, because I don't want to deal with any of that. I hate dealing with the schools. I never like dealing with the schools. I don't even like picking children up from school. It's just awkward. It's very awkward. I don't like it. And it's just become very strange these days also. They got like these little video cameras on the door. It's like, what is going on here? Okay. And I get it. Safety, a lot of shootings at schools. Speaking of shootings at schools, they actually had in the news today, I guess it was like a memorial for the Nashville school shooting that happened back in March. And just wanted to lay out, if anybody's from Nashville, I've been to Nashville. I love Nashville. Get some really good barbecue out in Nashville, too. It's a nice city. Traffic can be really bad, like any city, many major city. I did like the area, though. I love Nashville. And my prayers go out to the families, if anybody's listening. Probably not. This is a new show. Probably not reaching anybody from over there. But anyway, prayers out to the children. There's three kids that died and three adults. So apparently there was a school shooter. He killed people. Blah, blah, blah. Why are all these people going after schools? What is the story? Why? What is the obsession with schools? I guess there's a lot of people. I guess, you know, children are easy to kill. I guess they're defenseless. I guess that's part of it. Why not go to a mall? Seriously. I mean, if you were thinking about shooting up a place, I would think about a mall. There's a lot of people. There's a lot more people. It's kind of like open space, you know. I don't know. It just sounds like a better suggestion, I guess. I mean, it to me, it never made any sense, you know. Apparently, the guy shot like 152 bullets and killed six people. He used an AR-15, and he shot 152 bullets and killed six people. So obviously, this guy was not a skilled shooter, like, by any means, okay? I'm not a super skilled shooter, okay? I shoot. I go shooting. I probably go shooting maybe once a month. And I'm a good shot. I'm a decent shot. I'm, you know, I'm not a perfect shot. I'm not one of these guys who, you know, could make these shots from, you know, 1,200 yards, you know, half a mile. I'm not one of them guys. I've never tried to be one of them guys. I can make a decent shot, though, you know, a couple hundred feet, a few hundred feet. I could do quite well. But anyway, this guy gets an AR-15 and goes and shoots up a school. Why do these people shoot up these schools? I just don't get it. I don't understand it. Why shoot up a school? Yeah, it baffles me, you know? I mean, most people like children, I would think. A defenseless child, it just doesn't make any sense to me. You know, I don't get it. It's very sick. Obviously, these people are not thinking in their right mind, because obviously, you know, they're going to kill people anyway. I'd really like to know what drives these people. How do they become so desperate that they think that killing other people is a good idea? Is it in our culture that's wrong? Is it just sickness? Is it mental health? What exactly is it? What is the problem? What are we doing wrong in America that has led to so many of these shootings? Because it seems like it's happening all the time now. It seems like it's happening all the time. I mean, every other few months you hear, or every other month you hear about this shooting, that shooting, the Texas shooting. It's getting out of control. Look at the Vegas shooting. That guy walked in with an arsenal, and I don't even know how he didn't kill more people than what he did. I mean, thank God these people have terrible aim, and let's hope that they continue to have terrible aim. Let's hope that their bullets find nothing, nobody. I really do, because it's terrible. You know, I think about my own children at school. I worry about their safety. You know, these days you have to have a gun. You have to have guns. I have probably a dozen guns. I have handguns. I have, you know, I have a 1911. I have a couple 9mm. I have probably at least six shotguns. I have a 30-06. I have an AR-15. Yeah, I do have an AR-15. Some people are against it. Some people obviously are not. I mean, honestly, it makes no difference. No difference if you have an AR-15 or not, okay? None. It's just what I like to shoot with, that's all. A lot of people I've heard say, oh, it's a weapon of destruction, it's a military weapon. No, it's not, okay? It is not, okay? If you're thinking of like the M16 or you know, some of the other guns that are automatic weapons, it is not an automatic weapon. the AR-15. Okay, it's small caliber, you know, 223, unless you go up to the higher one. But anyway, I don't want to get into all that. Anyway, the point though is that any gun is dangerous. Any gun. Doesn't matter how big or little. A 9mm could kill somebody just as easily as, you know, a hand cannon or, you know, a shotgun or, you know, guns are dangerous. Everybody knows guns are dangerous. That's why it is so important people practice safety with guns, and it is so important that guns do not get into the wrong hands. Now, when I say the wrong hands, I don't mean criminals. Criminals are always going to get a hold of guns. It's too easy. It's too easy. There's too big of an industry to not sell criminals guns. It's just people are greedy and people don't care. You know, they're immoral. They don't care. They don't care who they hurt. They don't care who they kill. People just, you know, it's money to them. It's greed. Doesn't matter. Anyway, politics, a lot of stuff going on, guns, prayers to the Nashville families. I got into my Spotify this afternoon and started listening to music, and I logged on to their like top 50. I gotta say, it is terrible. Okay, no offense, Spotify. I love Spotify. I'm on Spotify, but the new music in this generation is terrible. When I say terrible, I mean awful. I was listening to top 50 song after song after song after song. It's terrible. It's awful. Can't listen. It's not even listenable. Put it to you that way, if that's a word. You can't listen to it. It stinks. It's terrible. It stinks. I want to say that again. It stinks. Okay? They need to just... I'll put it to you this way. I ended up going back to, I think it's like Throwback Thursday, or I don't even remember what it's called. And they have the list of the late 90s, mid 90s, and some early 2000s. That's what I wanted to stick to. Limp Bizkit, Korn, Metallica, Slipknot, Disturbed, you know, Linkin Park, all these bands. Love them bands. That is my music. Late 90s rock, mid 90s rock, early 90s rock. I do love classic rock too, don't get me wrong. I love classic rock. I love the Beatles. I love Creedence. I love the Stones. I love just about everything. I love Ozzy. I love all kinds of metal. I love all everything. I love Slayer. I love Megadeth. I love Pantera. Walk. Yeah. I mean, I love it. I remember when Dimebag Darrell got shot when he was, I think he was either coming out of the club where he was playing, or he was on stage. I think he was coming out and he got shot. I can't remember. I'd have to look that up. But anyway, prayers to Dimebag Darrell. Loved him. Great musician. Made so much good music. If you don't know Pantera, I'm sure most of you do. They've been around forever. They're, you know, huge band. They're basically classic at this point. If you'd never heard of them, or you're a kid, or whatever you are, check them out. Walk. That's all I gotta say. They may have a lot of other songs too, but that's my favorite. Anyway, so Trump ends up going to court today. Talk politics. Trump ends up going to court. He's got a civil matter or something going on, and he ends up getting in trouble, I guess, in the courtroom. And the judge, I guess he told him to sit down and stick to the point, or stick to the whole point was that Trump, I guess, was speaking and he was getting off topic. So the judge tells him to basically shut up and sit down. And if he's not going to stay on point, basically he's going to hold him in like contempt or something. It's like, God, man, you know, at what point, sometimes you just need to shut up. You know, I get it. He's upset. Anybody would be upset. I'd be upset if I got to go to court. I one time had to go to court because I had an ex-wife and she had a kid that wasn't mine. I had to go to court because she filed for Medicaid, okay, and it came up that we were married and she was alive. I guess, you know, she had the child before we got married, etc. It wasn't my child. And I had to go to court for this. And mind you, this is like 10 years after I was already divorced, and they want me to go to court, and I had to go do a DNA test, even though I did a DNA test when we got divorced. Tell me that's not effing weird. Tell me that's not stupid and a waste of time and a waste of money and a waste of resources and a waste of the court's time. I mean, geez, just trying to nab healthcare on anybody that they could so that they don't have to pay for it. Now, should the mother be giving her healthcare? Yes. Can she afford it? I have no idea. I don't talk to the mother. That's none of my business. I haven't spoken to her in years. And anyway, back to, so I brought that up because, you know, the whole court thing, nobody wants to go to court, okay? I don't even want to serve on a jury. I'll put it to you that way. It just doesn't interest me. Now, if I had like a murder trial, maybe. Because I find that sort of thing interesting, although I don't want to send anybody to their death, but at the same time, justice does need to prevail. And justice system already has enough issues in this country. Anyway. So, sports. I was thinking about sports. Last night, I did the other podcast. We talked about sports a little bit. I figured tonight we'd dive into a couple other things a little further. Cowboys suffered a huge loss to the Eagles. Huge loss. I know Cowboys fans definitely felt that. I thought their quarterback, Preston, did really... I mean, I think he did amazing. He played well enough to win that game. I think he could have won that game, but they just, the last couple decades, the Cowboys always seem to be just short. Just short. It's amazing. I never seen anything like it. See, I watched the Cowboys growing up in the early 90s, mid-90s, late 90s. I seen their Super Bowl runs. Heck, I went to one of their Super Bowls, okay? And they played unbelievable. I mean, it was like magic. It was incredible the way they played, those teams. They were legendary. And it was like they could do no wrong, those teams. And now it's like they could do no right, it almost seems. It always seems like they're just short of winning. And it's such a shame, too. And it was to the Eagles, and that's, we all know how that is. That's already a rivalry right there. But, so they ended up beating them. So far, in the football, AFC and NFC, the Chiefs are looking good. The Jaguars are looking pretty good. The Steelers, they're always in it. Usually, most of the time, anyway. The Steelers, I mean, listen, they are a legendary team going back decades, okay? Their history speaks for itself. They are, you know, they've fielded many great teams, and you just never know when they're going to click. I mean... I never count out the Steelers. I'm not actually a Steelers fan, but I can never count out the Steelers. You know, they've done amazing things. And just when I thought that they wouldn't win, I mean, plenty of those Super Bowls that they won, they ended up coming out with them. I couldn't even believe it. Anyway, Chiefs, Jaguars, Steelers, expectations I thought could have been, I thought were much bigger on the Bills, Buffalo. I was actually surprised. I was really shocked that the Bills have not performed better. I really have been. I think they've disappointed. I think that they have not played up to their ability. I think last year they looked much better. As far as the NFC, I'm thinking as far as like Super Bowl or who's going to come close to the Super Bowl or in the Super Bowl, how could you not look at the Eagles? The Eagles have played ridiculously good. When I say ridiculously, I mean they have played amazing. And then, honestly, the other team I got, as far as Super Bowl picks, Eagles, Cowboys. You know, you never know with the Cowboys. Maybe they get redemption. It's hard to say. You know, maybe they pull it out. And, you know, it's hard to say. I think everybody is, in the NFC, everybody else has been mediocre at best. Definitely mediocre. Maybe the Vikings, but even they've been, they have just not been good. They haven't played good. They haven't played good on both sides of the ball. They just haven't been. It's, you know when you watch a team, you don't get that special feeling about them. I'll put it to you that way. You know, a few years ago, I thought the Raiders might do better. They were starting to look pretty good the last couple seasons. Now they're in the tank. They're not doing well. The Lions have actually shocked a few people, but the Lions have never, it's been a long time since the Lions have been really good. And as far as expectations on the Lions, you know, I mean, sometimes you get shocked, you know. The team that doesn't have any expectations on it sometimes is the team that goes the furthest. It's, you know, look at Arizona this year in the World Series. I mean, you know, they basically laid down to the Rangers. They got their butt spanked, but, you know, nobody expected them. Nobody expected them at all. You know, we all thought it was going to be the Braves. I mean, I thought it was going to be the Braves. I thought it was either going to be the Braves versus the Astros, or I thought it was going to be the Braves versus the Rangers. I knew it was between them, the Braves, and Philly. I knew it was going to be a battle, but that's who I had picked. And it's going to be interesting to see how that offseason goes as well as far as baseball. Because there's a lot going on in baseball. There really is. This offseason is going to be pretty crazy. I wanted to talk a little baseball too. I also could talk a little basketball. I think the Celtics have looked really good before I get into baseball. The Nuggets have looked really good. The Warriors are always the Warriors. They've looked really good as well. I think that the Warriors will be there. The Nuggets will probably be there. And the Celtics have looked amazing. I mean, that's just my pick right now. The Lakers have looked like trash. They just have not played well. You know, I don't know what's going on there. The Mavericks have looked pretty good. They haven't, you know, they've played pretty well, you know. That's about it as far as basketball. Who do I think will be in the NBA, you know, the finals? Yeah, maybe the Celtics. You know, we'll see. We got a lot of time. You know, it's early in the season. You got a lot of games to go. So I'm just going to leave that floating out there for now. You know, we'll talk about that later on in the season, possibly. But, you know, I don't think LeBron's going to be carrying them to any trophies this year, unfortunately. Anyway, back to baseball. Free agency. Free agency in baseball. This is going to be the craziest, wildest free agency probably in maybe even the history of baseball because of Ohtani. Ohtani, obviously, everybody just about knows who Ohtani is, okay? If you don't know who Ohtani is, you better go Google him right now, okay? Because he is a great player. He really, truly is. The problem is, what I see with Ohtani is, can he keep up the numbers? Can he keep putting up the stats at this pace? And does he burn out early? Meaning, you know, if he gets an 8, 9, 10-year contract, let's say 10 years. Let's say the Angels offer him 10 years, $500 million on the dot. 10 years, $500 million. And he takes it. I don't think he will, but let's say he takes it. You know, he's been nestled in there. It's hard to say where he's going to go, but the Angels honestly have the most to lose right now if they lose him. If they lose him, they have the most to lose because of their fan base. You know, that's right now, that's their golden ticket. If they're not making the playoffs, they have to draw in crowds. They have to sell merch. They have to have people watching them, at least on the TV somewhat. Otherwise, they're in the hole. They lose Ohtani and that team's in trouble. You might as well start paying off some of Trout's salary and shipping him out, because it's going to be a disaster. It truly is. You know, I thought they'd be better this year than what they were, and we'll see what they do. I mean, Ohtani's now going to be the focus this offseason, so it's going to be really interesting. I love sports. I just wanted to let you know I follow all the teams. I'm not just I follow the Celtics, I follow the Bills, I follow the Jets, I even follow the Pats, even though they stink. And I love that the Pats stink. I'm sorry I shied away from baseball for just a sec, but I just wanted to explain to everybody that I am an overall sports fan, and I'm honestly not biased. I mean, you know, obviously you're always going to have your favorites, but I try to stay as fair as I possibly could, okay? This year, I was really, really pulling for the Braves. You know, it just seemed like a special year. You know, they were launching home runs. They are playing great defense. They're winning these clutch games. They're winning game after game after game, and it just looked like magic. Okay, it looked good. They ended up losing. It's an all well, right? And then the Phils ended up losing. I was shocked to see the Phils lose. I was absolutely almost fall out of my chair. The Arizona beating them after they went up 2-0 in their home. What the heck happened? That would be my first question as a general manager or as an owner. How do we go up 2-0 and then lose this series? I mean, it's a joke. It really is. They ended up losing the last 2 games at home. And that was it. I mean, how do you lose? You have Harper. You have, you know, you had your aces going. It's ridiculous. I mean, this Arizona team had 82 wins. They weren't even, or it was 84 wins. They weren't even supposed to be there. I mean, truly, they weren't even supposed to be there. And you lost to a team that wasn't supposed to be there. I mean, it happens, right? But it's just, you know, after seeing last year's World Series, I really wanted to see a rematch. That was part of the reason. I wanted to see Phillies, Astros. I wanted to see maybe, you know, Phillies have improved, Trey Turner. You know, their bullpen looks much better this year than it did last year. I wanted to see, okay, you know, how do they play now? You got Castellanos, who's playing far superior this year than what he did last year. Last year, he was playing like trash in the postseason. Trash last year. I watched him. I was like, God, dude. Thank God we didn't get him. But anyway, free agency, Ohtani. Angel, not Angel, Seattle, who knows? Can he keep it up? That was the original question. Can he keep it up? I don't know. If I was an owner or I was a GM, I'd be very reluctant, outside of the Angels, to offer him 10 years, $500 million. I mean, the guy's just had too many injuries so far. Way too many injuries. He just keeps getting injured. I mean, he's put up some really great numbers, and he can truly do some amazing things. He can pitch you a complete game shutout and win with a home run that game. The problem, though, is in order for you to pay a player that much, they have, and in order for him to make an impact on that team, a serious impact, he has to be available. If you're not available because you're trying to do too much, it's just no good. It ends up being counterproductive, and it ends up hurting your team because now they're stuck paying you $50 million a year. So not only is the payroll now tightening around the belt, you can't do anything. I mean, you have no options. And you have all this money invested in one player. Honestly, if I was the Angels, man, I would offer him, especially now he can't pitch next season. I'd almost overpay him and take less years, because I mean, it's too much risk. How many of these contracts do we see and they don't work out? They don't work out. They stink. I mean, it's terrible. Look at the Pujols contract. Look at all these contracts. It's awful. Look at the Yankees. Look at Stanton's contract. Wasn't he having like a $300 million contract? It's insane. Insane. I mean, it's gone from one extreme to the other, and that's baseball, and that's been like that. I mean, look at basketball, too, and football. It's been insane. It's been absolutely nuts. But anyway, so free agency, Ohtani, find the Angels. 5 years, maybe, I don't know, maybe you give him the 50 mil over 5 years. Maybe you go 6 years, 50 mil. That way it's an even, you know, even 300. I mean, it's still handicapped you, but at least it isn't 10 years. I mean, at 6 years, 50 million per, 300 mil. These guys are getting 10 years, 12 years, 300 mil. He's literally making double. I mean, it's ridiculous. If you look at some of the big contracts that have been signed, Machado's, Stanton's, Harper. Harper's actually is a good deal. I think Harper was like 12 years, I want to say $315 million or $320 or $330, something like that. But that's actually a good deal for him. you know, what is that, about 25, 27 mil a year? I mean, he puts up huge numbers, and he has been one of the most clutch players. I mean, he is the Phillies. The Phillies wouldn't be anywhere near as good without Bryce Harper. Bryce Harper was definitely, him as a free agent was definitely a good bargain. We'll see how the end of the contract goes, but he is also still very young. Very young he still is, so we'll see about what happens with that. Anyway, so baseball free agency, you got Cody Bellinger, you got some other players going on. It's going to be interesting to see. I know the Yankees did some kind of internal audit. I mean, what is going on with them? World Series ratings this year. I loved the World Series. Love to see the Rangers win. First time ever, but the ratings stunk. They stunk. The Astros-Rangers series was pretty good, but other than that, most of the playoffs stunk. You need the evil empire in order to put out a decent postseason. You know, even if they win, they lose, whatever. It's just more exciting. It really is. It's just more exciting. You know, and you know, that's basically that. I'm going to get back into some other things. For one thing, I wanted to talk about this. My mother-in-law sends me and my wife a sex toy today in the mail. I get a sex toy in the mail. Like, what the fuck is this thing? It looks like something you pinch your nose with. Looks like something you'd stick on your nose as almost like you put a clothespin on your nose. I'm like, what is this thing? I figured it was some kind of toy, but I have no idea. My mother-in-law sends it to me. I'm like, yeah, it's what I need from her. Anyway, my wife looks at it and she's like, we don't need that anyway. You know, I have a very good love life, even though we have 4 kids. We would have had 10 kids if we could have. My wife had a hysterectomy, and believe me, we would have had 5 more if we didn't get, she didn't get one, put it to you that way. Because we've always had a very, very, very strong, good sex life, and that is the key. That is one of the keys to a very healthy, good marriage, let me tell you. You know, anytime that me and her, you know, were not getting along or we were having problems, we were not doing what we needed to do in the bedroom. So strong sex life and communication, I'd have to say. We really, we've gotten a lot closer these last few years. We have. It's gotten really good between me and her. It's gotten better than it ever was, actually. And, you know, as they say, the best is yet to come, right? But anyway, thanks, mother-in-law. you can have it back now. Anyway, other things in the news that's been going on. I saw that Matthew Perry was ended up dying. Question is, was it suicide, overdose? Did he drown? Not really sure. I've been reading the news on it. They've said some things, and the coroner this, and the coroner that, and they found, you know, a bunch of drugs around him. Apparently he had, painkillers and something else, like Adderall or something. It's crazy. I mean, rest in peace, Matthew Perry. He was on that show Friends, if you don't know who he is. Good actor. Apparently he abused substances for years, and he even wrote, I guess in his book, I guess he stated that his substance abuse was going to be the death of him or the end of him, and it ended up being, and that's really sad. That's, you know, my heart goes out to the family. That's, you never want to see anything like that. I've known people that overdosed. I had somebody very close to me die of heroin. This is back 15 years ago, and it's very sad when people die. When you lose people, he was, from what I understand, he was a pretty good guy. He donated to charities. You know, he wasn't one of these money-hungry moguls that you know today. It's like so many. Anyway, you know, rest in peace, Matthew Perry. It's, you know, I'd like to stay current on that, but because I'd honestly like to know. I mean, he died apparently in his hot tub. How does that happen? I mean, did he fall asleep? I mean, it's just, I don't know. Anyway, you know, a lot of my inspiration for doing these podcasts, I actually grew up a Howard Stern fan, in case you couldn't tell. That's why I introduced so much of my private life and so much of my life into the show. I'm going to be putting a good amount into it as far as my family. I have three boys. I have my oldest is a girl. My wife, she's 32. I'm 38. So I'm a little older than her, obviously. Actually, I think I'm 37. Yeah, 37. My bad. But anyway, I try to make it as personable as I can. You know, I grew up idolizing and listening and watching Howard Stern. Loved Howard still to this day. I know he's a little less popular today because of, you know, people have said Howard's gone woke. Let me tell you, Howard has never really been woke. Okay, Howard has always been the edgy bad guy. Always the bad guy. He's always been the bad guy. You know, the guy who, you know, is going to do the most insane thing he possibly could. They've said he's woke because, I don't know, vaccines or this or that, or because he, you know, didn't want to go out during COVID. Honestly, I don't blame him. You know, I honestly don't blame him. I think there was too many people going out during COVID, having these COVID parties. I mean, it's a matter of opinion. You know, the whole thing, and the whole thing around the vaccine, yes, it should be a choice. Vaccines should be a choice. Now, when a child is born and they're a baby and they have to get those early vaccines, I 100% think that they should. As far as like the flu vaccine every year and stuff like that, I mean, do it at your discretion. Listen, if you keep getting the flu, if you keep getting the flu and you get really freaking sick, go get a vaccine, okay? Some people fight the flu better than other people. Me, personally, I don't have a spleen. I had my spleen removed 2 years ago. So if I get sick, I get very sick. I get sicker than most people because your spleen filters out bacteria out of your blood. So it makes me a lot more risk for sepsis and stuff like that. I'm considered immunocompromised. Am I vaccinated? Absolutely. Have I ever had any problems with it? None. Zero. Have I known anybody who's had problems with it? No. Zip. And I mean, I know people young, old. I know lots of, almost everybody I know is vaccinated. Nobody's had an issue. And their parents are vaccinated, and their cousins are vaccinated, and their friends are vaccinated. So never had a problem. I know there's stories out there, myocarditis and this and that. Honestly, COVID causes myocarditis. Colds cause myocarditis. Okay, myocarditis. So, I mean, you could catch it from anywhere, especially COVID. COVID causes it. So if COVID causes it, how could you ever say that it was a vaccine? I mean, listen, you might be against the vaccine, you might be for it. Either way, I agree, people have the right to choose. Okay, if you don't want to be vaccinated, you should not be forced to be vaccinated. But, you know, there were people who went into the hospital who weren't vaccinated, and then all of a sudden were like, give me the vaccine. Give me the vaccine. I want it. And it's too late now, you know. It's one of those things. But honestly, should you get vaccinated? I mean, that's not my place to say. Honestly, you're a grown adult in a free country, what should be a free country. That's your choice. You're a big boy. You're a big girl. If you want to get vaccinated, get vaccinated. If not, well, then don't. But if you catch COVID and you get very, very sick, I mean, listen, you can't be mad, and you can't be mad at people, and you can't blame others, and you can't, you know, there's been a lot of irrational thinking and behavior around COVID. I do have to say, it really seemed to put a chip in the rock, okay? What I mean by that is, like, it created an instability in people. And it's just, they become very triggered, very angry, very unstable, like. And it's just been surprising to see, honestly. You know, America has always been pretty, listen, it's had its moments. I'm not going to say it hasn't. But for the most part, they've always band together. And it's just, you know, it's just very shocking to see. It really is. But as far as, you know, vaccines, I mean, you have other vaccines. You have your tetanus, you have, you know, lots of other ones. You get vaccinated as a kid. Everybody, in order to go to school, you have to get vaccinated. So, I mean, you're going to sit here and say, well, I'm not going to get vaccinated, bad mouthing vaccinations. You've already been vaccinated. You know, I don't understand why it's, you know, why it's a big deal. But, hey, if it's a big deal, it's, you know, like I said, it's not my problem. You know, it's yours. you know, you're a big boy, big girl. But anyway, the whole thing around that is that I guess I feel that people should get vaccinated because I've seen what it can do. Okay? My dad ended up dying from COVID. Okay? And I think that if there was a vaccine available at that time, he would have gotten it for sure, but he could have lived. That's the point. I grew up with a single parent, okay? So my father was all I had. All I had. And his mother, okay? She basically was like my mother. My mother-father split up when I was two. So she was basically like a mother to me. My dad obviously was my dad. He was a young guy, you know. He went out. He, you know, he had a good time. But anyway, my dad was a very strong person. Very strong. When I say strong, this guy had the will of... I want to say the will of the biggest dinosaur you could imagine. I mean, this guy was so strong. You know, he was 6 foot. He was about 230, 240. And when I say big, he was muscular. But he wasn't just like a big muscle head. He was smart, intelligent. He, you know, he graduated from a good university, magnum cum laude. He was very intelligent. He taught me how to play chess. He was just, if there was something that he didn't know, he was going to go learn it. Okay. He didn't pay to get things done. He didn't pay, you know, if his car broke down, he fixed it. He replaced the motor himself. If he, you know, if something around the house needed fixing, he did it himself. You know, he never paid. And it wasn't just because he was cheap, because he absolutely was, but he just seen it as a challenge. Anything that was a challenge, he was down for. If, you know, if his car needed a new rear end, it didn't matter what kind of vehicle it was. If it needed a new transmission, he'd figure it out. That's just the type of person he was. Me, I'm good. I replaced the transmission once. I'll never do it again. Never again. I just wouldn't. It was terrible. It was the most god-awful experience I ever had, and I never want to even relive it. But anyway, strong man. God rest his soul. Rest in peace. My dad, he did pass away from COVID 3 years ago. I miss him every single day. Every single day. And I know many other people who have gotten COVID and passed away from it. My dad's girlfriend's mother passed away from it. I knew a couple friends from high school passed away from it in their 30s. Never got the vaccine. They passed away from COVID. They didn't have any problems with their health. Passed away from it. Okay, and I knew a bunch of other people who either got really sick and almost died, or died. And it's sad. It really is. It truly is. That anybody would pass on the vaccine after seeing what it could do to people. My dad, I explained on the last show, he went into a coma. He went into it for 2 weeks. And I didn't even get to say goodbye to him. I got to see him the night before he died on an iPad. And I got to take pictures of him. And he had all kinds of tubes. And he was... looked like he lost weight, and he looked like he aged 10 years in just a month, a few weeks, the last time I seen him, and he looked god-awful, and he ended up dying. And that was one of the strongest people I ever met in my life, just as far as mentally, physically. I mean, he was a specimen, put it to you that way. Like I said, specimen. He was a bodybuilder when he was younger, and he always worked out, stayed in phenomenal shape, bike ride, everything. This guy never walked, okay? This guy ran for everything. He was insane, okay? Absolutely nuts. He went to the beach. He was going for a run. Everything was running. He'd run everywhere. If he had to go to the store, I'm going to go run. You know, I'm going to literally go run up there. It was crazy. To him, everything was a challenge. Everything was exercise. He was going to fix everything with exercise. And to think that a virus took him out is just insane. Insane, insane. Anyway, God rest his soul. I love him to death. I wish there could have been a vaccine available for him. It might have saved his life. Because let me tell you, not a day has gone by that I don't miss him. Not a single day. And the same thing, his mother is still alive. His mother calls me every freaking day to tell me about how much she misses him, okay? Imagine that. She's 96 years old. This is my great-grandmother. No. She's my grandmother. It was my dad's mother. I'm sorry. It's my kid's great-grandmother. She's my grandmother, 96 years old, calls me every day. Calls me crying, calls me upset. I miss him. I love him. I can't believe he's not here. just, you know, what do you tell a mother? What do you tell her? Literally, it's been 3 years. I hurt too. I'm grieving still. I love my dad. What do you tell her? You know? Yeah, I don't know what to say. You know, I'm at a loss for words. You know, I've gotten her, try to get her into therapy. You know, she's upset over it. She's very upset. It turns out now she's had problem with her heart or something. It's not good. You know, it destroyed families, COVID. That's why so many people are upset about it. That's why so many people are, you know, trying to sue over it. That's why so many people, you know, were mad at Donald Trump over it. It was why so many people were mad about this, that, and the other thing, because it destroyed families. It truly did. My brother had four siblings. My father had four siblings, and, you know, every one of them got upset. They're all upset. His mother's upset. It's, you know, my kids are upset. They're still upset. They ask about him. It's just very sad. I got pictures of him. And it destroys families. I know plenty of other families, too. My friend, she had a son. She was a female. She was 40 years old at the time. I mean, I knew her. She didn't have any, as far as health problems, as far as I know. Very healthy-looking girl. And she passed away. And she left behind. She was single. She was a single mom, and she left behind her son. And now that's it. You know, the son now lives with other people, and it's, you know, it's, imagine not having a mother or a father. He's like 8 or 9 years old. Now he might be 11 or 12, but it's sad. It's sad what happens. You know, like I said, so many people are angry because it destroyed families, and that's part of the reason, too, why they want so many people to get vaccinated. You know, I was not a supporter of the mask. I hated the mask, but I wore the mask. I would wear it. I never really had that big of a deal wearing it. I didn't like wearing it, but I always felt that if wearing it could save somebody else's life, or somebody's grandfather, or somebody's father, or somebody's cousin, or somebody's brother, or somebody's sister, or anybody, even if they were immunocompromised or not, if wearing that mask, if I had to be uncomfortable wearing that mask so somebody else's grandparent can live, I would do it twice every day of the week, okay? If I had to wear that mask the rest of my life, I would do it. I don't want to kill anybody. I don't want to be the reason somebody gets COVID and brings it home. I couldn't live with that. I just couldn't. You know, these other people, they're not our enemies. It's not my enemy. Even somebody that I don't know. I don't want to hurt anybody else's family. You know, even somebody I don't know, I would feel bad about it. So it's not about me. You know, a lot of people I've heard, oh, you know, it's not my, you know, I got rights and I got this and I got that and, you know, this and that and I'm in a free country and why should I wear a mask? Honestly, it's not about us. That's why. Sometimes it's about something bigger. It's about a bigger picture. It's about a bigger moment in history. I wore a mask. I didn't like wearing a mask. I hated wearing a mask. I effing hated them. Okay. When I say I hated them, I had to keep them with me. Terrible. I have asthma and I got, you know, very bad allergies. So that mask effed with me really bad. So when I tell you I hated it, I absolutely hated it. But I will be, any day of the week, I will be uncomfortable if it saves somebody else's life. And COVID was deadly. It truly was. I had COVID a couple times. I felt like I was going to die. No kidding. I mean, I felt like I knew I had COVID. I just knew. I woke up one morning and my head was effing pounding. When I say it was pounding, I mean pounding. And my head was pounding. My eyes felt like they were going to pop out of the socket. I just felt like I couldn't even function, literally. I just tried to sit up and I was like, oh, I never lost taste. I never lost smell. They kind of dulled, but I never lost them completely. I tested positive, and I tested myself like 5 times. Okay. It wasn't just like, hey, you know, I tested once and it was positive, and 2 weeks later, I'll put it this way. I took like 3 at home tests, and then I went to CVS and took their tests, you know, the one where they send it off, not just the rapid test, but the one they send off, all positive. I knew I was sick. I knew it was terrible and it was god awful. At one point, I had COVID and type B of the flu at the same time. I felt like I was going to die. Okay. It was just awful. Anyway, it's a choice. It's yours to make. As far as the mask, hated wearing the diaper face, but I would do it if it saved your grandfather. And, you know, that's just the way it is. I'm American and I care about other Americans. You know, say what you want about me, but I care about other people and we should. It's the United States. It's not the divided states. And that's the way it should be. You know, I love America. I don't want to hurt any of its people. Matter of fact, I want it to flourish. I want it to prosper again. That's another thing. You know, we were talking earlier about politics and stuff. National debt. The national federal debt is in the trillions. It's like $35 trillion. How do you fix that? No president, not Trump, not Biden, none of these presidents can knock that down. How do you fix it? Seriously, you can post in the comments. How do you fix it? My take on it? You might not like my take. You may love my take. Okay? So, I've Googled how much America makes. Listen, you could either do two things. One, you can either raise taxes so high that everybody hates it. No, I don't think right now that's an option. You know, with everything, how much it's costing right now, I don't think that's an option. Inflation's back at 3%. The prices have not returned to 3%. You know, everybody's making out like a fat cow at this point. You know, corporate profits are through the roof. When I say through the roof, ExxonMobil's going to make, what, $35 to $40 billion this year? Their best year yet, ExxonMobil. You know, and that's a gas at $3, $4 a gallon. Why can't they charge $2 a gallon and make, I don't know, $20, $25 billion? Like, well, I mean, $25 billion is, you know, that's not peanuts we're talking here. We're talking about $25 billion profit. That's insane. But anyway, you know, McDonald's, their prices for a hamburger, you know, a lot of people, $15 an hour, hate to break it to you, they're making huge profits. Their profit's going to be like $15 billion this year. So that $15 an hour don't mean jack. What they did is they jacked everybody's pay up to $15 an hour, and then they cut their staff so that it was still as if they were still paying the staff the same amount. Like, for instance, you know, obviously if you're got a staff of, let's say, 10, right? You're paying them all, let's say, what, 10, 11 bucks an hour, right? Well, guess what? Now, if we only got a staff of, say, 7, you saved a lot of money. You might have gone up the pay 50% scale or so, but you cut back your workforce, you know, 30 to 40%, and now you raise your prices, you know, almost, you know, 30, 40, 50%. What do you think happens? Your profit goes through the roof. I mean, through the roof. McDonald's is on pace for $15 billion this year. Home Depot is on pace for like $150 billion. I mean, it's absolutely insane. It's insane. How much money do you need? How much money? How much money does Apple, Google, Amazon, how much money is it going to take before these people are satisfied? The answer is none. There's no answer to that. These people will never be satisfied. If they were making trillions, they wouldn't be satisfied. Okay? This is just the start of it. It is seriously just the start of it. They are going to make everything so expensive that America is only for the rich. That's what's going to have to happen. The way people came here because they looked for a better life and all that good jazz, people are eventually within probably 20. I mean, they're doing it now. I've seen podcasts and all that stuff. They're doing it now. They're moving out of the country. Over the next 20, 30 years, 40 years, people are going to be leaving in droves because they're not going to be able to afford to live here. The healthcare is going to be super expensive. It already is. I mean, healthcare is insane. I mean, it's become a lot. I told you I'm on right now. I'm disabled at the moment. My wife has brain surgery. She had 2 brain surgeries this year. It costs a lot. Medical bills cost a lot. Medical expenses. I think I've spent like $35,000 this year in medical expenses. That's seeing doctors. That's prescriptions. That's this. That's that. It's a lot of money. $35,000 I mean, the average salary in America is 50 grand, okay? 50, 55, almost 60, depending on where you live. Between 50 and 60,000. That's the average salary, okay? I paid 35,000 just in the medical bills. So you can imagine, when I worked, I had a really good salary. I made very, very good money. Because, you know, we have nice cars, we have a nice house, our house is paid off. You know, I'm only 37 years old, okay? I've done quite well, and I have investments on top of that. So I know a little bit about financial, this whole inflation, overcharging. I really call it price gouging, because that's exactly what it is, okay? It is not inflation, all this. This is price gouging, okay? They literally have made everything, some things double the price, sometimes even triple the price, okay? And meanwhile, they're shrinking it, okay? But meanwhile, their profits as a company are through the roof and they're making records. They're killing America. These people are literally sucking the blood. They are blood suckers. They are sucking the blood out of America, and we're letting them. Because that's what's really going on here. It isn't inflation. I hate to break it to you. Inflation's back down to normal levels. You know, it's not. Do you see, you know, when you go shopping, is there barely anything on the aisles? No. The aisles are full. It's not a supply problem. It's not the baby formula crisis or the toilet paper crisis. It's, well, let's see, we're McDonald's. And we want to make record profits this year, and we're going to make it on you. And it seems like people don't want to hold them accountable for that. They want to say, oh, it's 15 an hour, or this, or Joe Biden, or slice of cheese. Why not? No, it's not that. These people are making a living off of us, the American consumer, Americans. They are gutting American citizens of their money. And it's going to continue to happen. As long as people are willing to put up with it, they're going to continue to do it. That's just the way it is. Until somebody raves a beef, that's just the way it is. Are they going to lower their prices now that inflation's gone down? No! They're enjoying it too much. If anything, they're thinking of ways right now how to raise prices higher and make profits higher. You know why? Because 50 years ago, the American consumer and the employee mattered. 50 years to the present, they don't. Their profits matter. Their stockholders matter. That's who matters. I mean, if you know anything about America these days, or if you know anything about stocks and financial and how the actual country works and how it runs, you would know that the American consumer does mean dick. Okay? Means dick. The employee means nothing. Employee means nothing. They'll replace you. I was a number at my job. I was there 17, 18 years. I was a number. I told you, I missed anniversaries. I missed so much, so much. I missed birthdays. I had children calling me up crying. I missed so much. I traveled for years, you know, and that was my choice. But, hey, I lived a good life. I seen a lot. But anyway, I was just a number. I walked away. I was let go. And that's it, you know, no pension, no nothing. Just, here you go. Thanks. I didn't even get a thanks. I got contacted by HR. I didn't even get a call from my manager or my general manager or ops manager. I didn't even get a call from them. Nothing. Text, nothing. And these were people I considered friends. And I get an email from HR. Hey, we need to talk about your, you know, FMLA leave and all that stuff. And I'm just let go. That's it. That's the American dream. Serve 18 years of your life. Be loyal to, you know, one company, and boom, you're gone. You know, I had to have surgery. I just found out actually today, that was the other news I was going to bring up. Found out today I have to have shoulder surgery next Tuesday. So, you know, it is what it is. You know, there's nothing else I could do about it. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed the episode. I'll be on again tomorrow. I'll be putting up another show, and we'll talk more stuff, about more stuff, more music, more politics, more sports, more whatever you want to talk about, okay? I mean, I really enjoy talking about this stuff. I love it. I eat it up. You know, I never got into the gross federal debt. How do we solve it? I never got into that part. How do we solve it? I asked you, can you guys tell me? Here's how I would solve it. I would suspend tax returns. tax returns, they dole out about $4 to $5 trillion on tax returns each tax season. I would suspend tax returns for roughly 8 years or 7 or 8 years until, okay, let's just say 10 years, because as the debt's going to keep going up. 10 years. And in return for not giving people their tax returns, you make it up to them on the back end. They can collect their Social Security maybe earlier, say at 60 or, you know, maybe 62, or maybe you give them more money in their Social Security, or, you know, maybe you take care of their benefits. Maybe, you know, you just work it out. Hey, here's what we're going to do. I'm actually over an hour right now. I didn't think I was going to go this long. I was thinking about 45 minutes, but here's what I was thinking. Look, we're gonna cover your medical expenses. How about that? Instead of you being on, you know, whatever you're on, Blue Cross Blue Shield, United Healthcare, you know, whatever you're on, doesn't really matter. We're gonna stay on that, and you know what? The government's gonna cover your healthcare, because the government, they talk to these people, they work it out at a cheaper price. You know what I mean? The government, Medicaid doesn't pay what, say, United Healthcare pays. So Medicaid gets involved, maybe, or something like that. And, you know, maybe a person like me, say, I usually get some money back because I got kids. I got usually a lot of write-offs. I just know how to work the system, I guess. You know, try to write off as much as I can. I do home remodels and stuff like that. And I'll use every little bit of what I can to write off, and anything in business as well. But, I mean, that's what anybody does. But anyway, so you suspend tax returns for roughly 9-10 years. You pay the federal tax debt off with that. Now, does it suck? Absolutely. It absolutely sucks. Maybe you help people by, you know, maybe the lower and poorer class, maybe their taxes lower a little bit, say to 15-20%. That'll help offset some of the costs, and maybe you help out with their health care, or you take care of them on the back end with Social Security. Maybe they either collect more or they retire younger. Either way, they work it out. Tax returns are suspended. 10 years. Boom. You pay it off in 10 years. And then you don't ever speak of it again. Never. You never speak of debt again, and you don't go back into debt. No more wars. No more bullshit. You know, no more bullcrap, okay? They have spent money ridiculously. I've gone over an hour now into this conversation. I was going to do 45 minutes, but anyway, we've had a long talk. I enjoyed talking tonight. I love it. I absolutely love it. I could talk for hours. Anyway, I also wanted to give a shout out. Like I said, I love Howard Stern. That's kind of what my show is a little bit based off of. I haven't gotten to any funny stuff yet. I promise I will, and giveaways and prizes and all kinds of stuff. This has been more of an introductory still. Still getting used to it, too. Anyway, I hope you had a good session. I certainly did. I think of it as therapy at this point. Anyway, God bless America. I love America. Have a good night. Safe day. Drive safe. There's a lot of crazy people out there. And have a great night. I hope you enjoyed the episode. All right. Good night. Bye.
Children bright, ripple is burning, and the girls are getting sick. Snorting coca in the bathrooms while boyfriends pick up chicks. Darling, I'm lost. I heard you whispering that night in Fountain Square. Trash-filled streets made me wish you were heading home. There was love inside the basement where that woman used to lie. In the sleeping bag we shared on the floor most every night. And darling, I'm drunk, and everything that we love has turned to stone. To pack your bags and just come back home. And I'm wasted, you can't taste it. Don't look at me that way, 'cause I'll be hanging from the rope. I will haunt you like a ghost. If my woman was a fire, she'd burn out before I wake. Be replaced by pints of whiskey, cigarettes, outer space. When somebody moves, and everything that we have turns to stone. So pack your bags, come back home. And I wrote this on an airplane where the people looked like ants, and the woman that you loved was gone. She's bombing East Japan. Don't fucking move, 'cause everything that we have will turn to shit. But we've got a lot, don't you dare forget. 'Cause I'm wasted, you can taste it. Don't look at me that way, 'cause I'll be hanging from a rope. I will haunt you like a ghost. Thank you.